I'd like to welcome everyone to the monthly meeting of the Tyler Independent School District Board of Trustees. This meeting was previously called to order, and notice of the meeting has been posted in the time and manner required. We are now reconvening from executive session, and the first item we have on the agenda tonight is actually the prayer and pledge of allegiance for with Reverend Fritz Hager. If everybody could please stand.
Heavenly Father, your word tells us that the beginning of knowledge is the fear of you. And so it's right for us to come to you and ask for wisdom and for knowledge tonight. Father, you are the source of all wisdom, and we are in desperate need of your guidance and of understanding of your will. Father, you also ask us to seek the welfare of our city. And so as we work here tonight, we pray that our plans and our decisions and our actions would be honoring to you, and that they would indeed promote the welfare of this city. And Father, that you would bless the city of Tyler, the schools, the children, the teachers, and the administrators who serve you while they serve this community. We're grateful for all that you have done for us and all that you will do. I pray this in the name, the only name I know how to pray, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honors the Texas flag.
I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Okay, someone played a dirty trick. They moved the Texas flag from its regular spot. So, anyway.
Didn't stop.
Yeah.
We still pledged.
We still pledged.
Let's see, we don't have any personnel items, I don't believe, on that, do we? Okay, so then we go to board minutes of January 11th and January 21st. Board members, if there are any corrections, changes to those, please note them now.
I do have one. Mr. President, on page 10, the fourth full paragraph, where it lists Reverend Mason stated, it should be Mr. Burkfeld stated.
Mm-hmm. All right, it's noted. Any other changes? Okay, I'll take a motion. We approve the minutes of January 11th and 21st with the changes noted.
I move that we approve the minutes for January 11th and 21st with the noted changes.
Second?
I second the motion.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? All right, that motion carries. We go to special recognitions, and I believe we have a video to start out. All right.
Good evening, board members. Tonight, we'd like to begin our recognitions by announcing our two district students of the month. We would like to recognize Audrey Dethridge, a fourth grade student at Jack Elementary School, as the elementary student of the month. And our secondary student of the month is Kadarius Ross, and he's an 11th grade student at John Tyler High School. At this time, we'd now like to watch a brief video about both of these students.
Tyler ISD would like to recognize the efforts of our two district students of the month. These students are selected based on six criteria: academic performance, effort, character, behavior, citizenship, and attendance. We would like to recognize Audrey Dethridge, a fourth grade student at Jack Elementary, as our elementary student of the month. Audrey says she understands what it takes to be a good student.
Follow directions and be kind to everyone.
Audrey says her favorite classes are math and science. She has plans for the future and knows what she wants to be when she grows up.
When I grow up, I would like to be a doctor so I can help people.
Jack Elementary teachers say Audrey is viewed as an asset to the classroom and is seen as a valuable tutor to fellow classmates when needed. Audrey has advice for other students as to how to be successful in the classroom.
Try to be kind and like help people with everything and try not to get in trouble.
Our secondary student of the month is Kadarius Ross, an 11th grade student at John Tyler High School. Kadarius says one of his personal goals was to become the district student of the month.
At the beginning of the school year, I found out that there was another John Tyler student who had got student of the month. And I talked to him and I learned what he did to become the student of the month. So that made me want to work hard and become student of the month. So I started talking to my counselors, getting advice on how to work hard, how to get more involved in school. And then last Thursday, that's when I found out I was student of the month.
Kadarius is currently taking the Law Enforcement 2 course at the Career and Technology Center. He has been planning his future for many, many years.
Ever since I was younger, I've always wanted to work some form of law enforcement because I think that I fit to in with people who help to serve the greater good. I like helping people, I like being involved with people, I like meeting new people, and I also like working with people to develop a new skill. So law enforcement really caught my eye and made me want to pursue my dreams of becoming a lawyer. So that's why I chose the criminal justice career path, because of my dream.
Campus staff at John Tyler High School say Kadarius has a great attitude and has a passion for being involved in the community and helping others. He participates in 13 school organizations and says two of his favorite are the National Honor Society and the Criminal Justice Student Association.
Giving your time can really help another person. And then the next one would be Criminal Justice Student Association, because of the fact that we're an organization that deals with hands-on meeting police officers. So it allowed me to see them in a different light without the stereotypes and the things that we think of when we see a regular police officer. So because of this organization, I was able to grow and meet people, and not only people, develop new relationships with adults.
Congratulations to these students for their hard work, dedication, and leadership in the classroom. Their efforts are being recognized through TISD-TV and sponsorship by Trinity Mother Frances Hospitals and Clinics.
Okay, this time I'd like to ask Audrey to please come forward so we can recognize you as our Elementary Student of the Month. Our secondary student of the month, Kadarius, was very disappointed that he could not be here tonight, but he is actually representing Tyler ISD at the Regional Criminal Justice Competition in Waco. So we're very proud of him. We have invited him back to come in March to get his certificate at that time. So next, we'd like to recognize and congratulate three Robert E. Lee High School seniors, Veronica Sutton, Marlon Esparza, and Ileana Herrera, for being recognized by the College Board's National Hispanic Recognition Program. I want to tell you a little bit about this recognition. They were awarded, this award is to students for their outstanding scores on the preliminary SAT National Merit Scholarship qualifying test taken the junior year, combined with a cumulative GPA of 3.5 or higher. All three of these students continue to receive college acceptance letters and scholarship offers. Veronica and Marlon plan to attend the University of Texas at Austin and to earn degrees in international relations and also biology. Ileana plans to attend the University of Texas at Dallas, and she also might transfer to Austin to earn her degree in business with a concentration in entrepreneurship. So we are very proud of these students and want to ask them to come forward at this time. Next, Tyler ISD would like to recognize Edgar Gonzalez. He is a fourth grader at Orr Elementary School for his artistic accomplishment. Edgar's reflection entry, The Brain, has been advanced to state-level judging. This is a wonderful achievement as nearly 60,000 students participate in this program annually and less than 3% actually advance to Texas PTA. So we would like to ask Edward to please come forward at this time. Next, we'd like to recognize our Teacher of the Month. This teacher is Ricardo Alvarez. He's from Austin Elementary School. Mr. Alvarez is a fourth grade bilingual teacher, and this is his third year in Tyler ISD, and we are very proud of him and would like to honor him at this time. And finally tonight, we would like to recognize our hero for education. Each month this year, we're recognizing a teacher, a staff member, or an organization or community group for going up and beyond and for embodying Tyler ISD's mission and objectives on and off our campuses. Tonight, we'd like to recognize the CTC Construction Technology teacher, Ms. Deanna Malloy, and her students that are here with her. Her students work together to build, to design, and to sell dog and cat houses to benefit the Humane Society Pets for People organization. A total of 40 dog houses were auctioned to the public. They raised $3,500 for this organization. And also something that very special that happened that they did, they actually built a dog house for Tyler Canine Officer Ogre that recently was lost his life in line of duty. And they built the dog house. It was displayed at the memorial service. So we want to recognize these students, if they would please come forward, as well as Ms. Malloy. And one final note, I failed to mention that these students are now constructing benches, picnic tables, and fun obstacle courses for two-legged and four-legged guests to enjoy at the newly constructed pet park located at Pets for People. So thank you, students, for all of your work. And that concludes our recognitions. Thank you, board members.
Appreciate all of the students and employees of TISD that came out tonight and that do such wonderful things for the district. And speaking of that, I've got a statement here I want to read. Thank you to students and teachers. It is amazing what you can accomplish if you do not care who gets the credit. My life has been dedicated to the betterment of our schools and our children's future. The work that I do is not for credit or praise, but for our students. To be shown so much appreciation by each campus with the scrumptious goodies, pictures, cards, and gift cards has made my days even sweeter. Thank you all for thinking of me. The generosity that I have been shown is amazing. Thanks again, Gene Washington, TISD Board Member District 3. So, thank you. That is a wonderful night when we get our care packets. At this time, we are going to move to the public participation portion of our meeting. And we have three speakers tonight, and I'm going to read a statement just so we can outline the guidelines of our public participation section of our meeting. We are at the board wishes to hear and your thoughts and concerns. As per board policy, all speakers must have submitted a speaker participation form at least 10 minutes prior to the start of our regular session. All registered speakers should have received a card with our guidelines for your presentation. We ask those in the audience to refrain from responding to the speaker's comments, including cheering and applauding. This will enable the board members to focus their attention entirely on the speakers. Although the board may ask clarifying questions, please be reminded that board members cannot respond to any comments. Each speaker will have 5 minutes, and the first speaker is Ethel J. Hawkins. Ms. Hawkins, if you'll step up to the podium, please.
Good evening to the board, to the community. I want to first congratulate our district on the article that was in the paper today with Senator John Crum praising the New Career and Technology Center. I think that was so awesome because one of my passions is a lot of students can learn well through their careers where their heart and passion is, and I just love that career center. So I want to congratulate our district for Senator Crum and the article, awesome article in today's paper. As you know, I always come and talk about the Faith Action Network as one of my pet passions. I really want to thank this district for recognizing, and this is second school year to have the Faith Action Network, and I think it's really phenomenal. And for those, just a reminder that the Faith Action Network is comprised of pastors and representatives of local faith-based organizations who plan to meet once per semester. Meeting discussions will help keep you informed of student and campus needs across the district. We will also brainstorm on ways to help meet these needs. The Tyler ISD Faith Action Network and the Tyler ISD School Resource Police Officers and Crossroads Sports Church for Girls and Tyler ISD pastors who work and teach in Tyler ISD, putting our faith in action for the educational success of students, parents, and faculty members. I was really encouraged to know that they reached out to the community pastors, and about maybe a couple of months ago, the Lord reminded me that we have pastors on some of our campuses that teach at schools, that are administrators, and that was really phenomenal. And also, we just really appreciate the school resource police officers that really work with us and really encourage us. And I don't want to call the name of the school, but there is a school in our district that every Wednesday morning at 8 a.m., administrators, the principal, teachers, counselors, they actually have prayer meeting and Bible lesson at this school. And that is so, so encouraging. I would just want to personally thank you again that we have the Faith Action Network. And also, I want to share a little, in my little 5 minutes, of a Bible lesson about Faith Action Network from the book of James, chapter 2, verse 14 through 18, where it says, faith without works is dead. Verse 14 says, what good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith, but don't show it by your actions? Can that kind of faith save anyone? Verse 15, suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, verse 16, and you say goodbye and have a good day. Stay warm and eat well. but then you don't give that person any food or clothing, what good does that do? Verse 17. So you see, faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces good deeds and is dead and useless. Verse 18. Now someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. And there's a life recovery Bible lesson on that. It says, faith is the cornerstone of recovery, and it needs to be accompanied by action. Faith by itself is not enough. Unless faith produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. If we believe God can help us but refuse to obey his will, we prove that our faith is dead. True faith is God expressing itself in committed action, and actions need to back up our words if we want to succeed. Tyler ISD is blessed to have pastors and faith-based representatives who work, teach, and are principals. Tyler ISD is blessed to have pastors and faith-based representatives on our school board. For the educational success of all students, all parents, all family members, and all friends, it will please God if all of us work together as faith action partners. Together, all of us putting our faith in action for the glory of God, the kingdom of God, and the children of God. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hawkins. Next speaker is Misty Kinnett. Is that right? All right.
I'm a little nervous. So, my name is Misty Kinnett. I have two children that are enrolled currently, TISD. They go to Hubbard. They're in the eighth grade. One of them is here. I've actually had three children enrolled at TISD. My older son graduated already, successful in the military, graduated from Robert E. Lee, as did I. My complaint is regarding a teacher and also Dr. Crawford, and he's aware of the circumstances. I'll just give you a little brief history here. It's been nearly a year. April 23rd of last year, I was at work. I work for a physician, and my phone was on silent, and I got a text message from my son, and all it said was, "What is the name of our birth father?" That was all it said. So I wasn't sure kind of what was going on or what was happening. I thought maybe he just all of a sudden was curious. I didn't really know. My daughter, they're twins. Of course, both my kids know they were adopted. My daughter knew about 80% of the story. Female, curious, you know, women ask more questions. My son never really wanted to know. I mean, he knew he was adopted. That's pretty much all he wanted to know. He's never really asked questions. He just didn't care. So I was a little bit concerned that I got the text message from him. Since I did have patients in the office, I just called the school. I asked for the principal. He wasn't available, so I told the girl at the front desk. I said, you know, I don't know what's going on in Ms. Clower's class. I have no idea. I said, but if you could just go down there, tell her whatever they're talking about, it needs to stop. We need to stop this now. When I picked my kids up that afternoon, I was informed that evening that Miss Amanda Clower, who was a science teacher, not only was she questioning the name of the biological parents, but she got on her computer and asked my daughter his name. My daughter gave the first name correctly, but she gave the wrong last name. She said Stephen Johnson. At that time, Ms. Clower, on her computer, we're not sure where she went, but she did pull up a Stephen Johnson, who did have a criminal background. He was a black gentleman, so obviously it was not the correct biological father. She continued her research, and then she said, you know what? I think he's a sex offender. And at that time, my son went and sat down, and that's when I got the text message. I'm not going to go on with the story. I think that's all you need to know as far as what happened in the classroom. There was a third student involved. That's her story to tell. Her mother, I've spoke with her. The next morning, which was April 24th, Ms. Clower did call me. She didn't apologize. She said that my daughter was the one questioning her about her birth parents because she knew that Ms. Clower had formerly worked for the state. I'm not sure how. And that's not true. And she said, I said, why did you say sex offender? She said, well, I just wanted to make sure he wasn't, because if he was, I was going to let you know. And I said, I don't even understand why you're saying any of this to me. I said, I know everything there is to know about the birth parents. My children were adopted through CPS. I know everything there is to know. And she informed me that her sister was adopted, so just recently when this was going on, that they had been trying to find her real family. And she said, so I know exactly what you're going through, Ms. Kennett. I stopped her. I said, I'm going to stop you right there. I said, first of all, we're talking about two 13-year-old kids. You're an adult. And I said, their real family is me and my husband, my sister. So I was greatly offended by that. She continued to not call me their real mother. So basically, that's what happened there.
You've got about 30 seconds left. If you
okay.
Can kinda...
I tried multiple times to reach Dr. Crawford. He did not want to meet with me. I hired an attorney just to send him a letter to say she's not allowed around my children. His exact words were, I'm not sure if I got that letter. I get so many, I'm not sure. I said, did you see my interview on KLTV? He said, I pay no attention to that. And I said, can you just apologize to my kids? Can you do the right thing and apologize to my kids? You said, you looked me straight in the face, and you said, I'm not going to do that. And I said, why? And you said, because I don't know your children. That's exactly what you said to me. This is my daughter, Katie Ann Kennett. You owe her an apology, and the teacher owes her an apology. Because of this and what happened, it's been horrible for our family. There's a box right there. Every single thing in that box is what my children went through. You have no idea what we've been through as a family, and you just made it even worse when all you had to do was apologize. That's all you had to do. You did talk to me in December. You said, I will let you know when you can meet with the teacher in January, and I have yet to hear from you, and we're in February. So I'm still waiting on that phone call.
It's been 6 minutes.
Thank you.
Is that it? Okay, thank you. Next speaker is Mr. Bob Brewer.
Hello.
Hi, Mr. Brewer.
I guess Ethel's rubbing off on me, and I'm maybe putting some faith into action. On MLK Day, I got to meet one of your students who read from MLK's speech. I thought he was utterly fantastic. After a day later, he was reminiscing, and he was praying somebody would go up there and recognize his performance, and I was the first person to go shake his hand. He's truly exceptional. Less than 30 minutes ago, I got back from the national qualifying debate tournament that they were having, Lindale's having at New Harmony. He didn't qualify. He still has another opportunity over the weekend. His partner did. Anyway, so that's a bright spot as far as TISD goes. And he's also going to be at the Liberty Hall event on the 29th. So I would encourage all of you to go there and listen to what this young gentleman has to say, because he's truly fantastic. Now, to get to the problems, I know desegregation was on the closed session agenda for this evening. And I've been working a lot in North Tyler at an old Roberts Junior High School, and it's the first private Christian school in North Tyler, and it's truly been a blessing for me and for the little kids that I see going there and everybody that comes to visit. And I get back to this swimming pool. I met one of the seniors on the Robert E. Lee swimming team. He says that the Fun Forest pool is perfectly fine. I've looked at it. To me, it seems like the field of dreams for swimmers. It's the perfect opportunity to express a sentiment to get rid of this desegregation order by melding some of the South with the North, rather than spending emergency funds a mile and a half south of Irwin Street when we've got a perfectly good pool 0.5 miles north of Front Street. I can't see spending emergency school funds when we've had problems with the school books. Some of your best students in TISD went 4 months without a textbook. This debate student qualified for finals in Maybank, and he was informed by his teacher that she couldn't be there for him to go to finals on the weekend, and he would have to spend $100 to pay for judges to go to the finals. He came in third. Anyway, he works 30 hours a week. His mom works 2 40-hour-a-week jobs, and they can't afford to be pulling money out of their hourly wages to pay for something that's, we're going to spend emergency funds on a swimming pool in South Tyler. So anyway, the other thing about the pool was we've got some representatives from the Brannan Corporation, and I talked to one of the guys that worked on the upgrade of that pool. 20 years ago, it was brought up to world-class Olympic standards, 316 stainless drip edge, which is the best you can get, and I just cannot imagine that it's fallen in disrepair where it's irrecoverable and can't be used. I swear it's the field of dreams for swimmers, and I would like to see this board change their mind on this, spending emergency funds in South Tyler when we have a perfectly good pool in North Tyler. We have a desegregation order that we need to get out from under, and I think this is your opportunity. Thank you.
We move next to the business, legal, finance, consent agenda. We're going to pull item D, and we are going to hear a motion to table items G and H, and then we will pull item I also. So board members need a motion on the other consent items. I can repeat them if we need to.
Besides D.
A, B, C, E, F.
I move we approve items A, B, C, E, and F.
All right. Is there a second?
Second motion.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Those carry. Item D, Dr. Crawford.
Yep. We're always happy to celebrate our partners. And on page 25 of your agenda packet, we have a donation of over $5,000 per district policy. The board considers and approves donations of $5,000 or more, and the following donation has a value of $6,517.33 from Jack Elementary PTA. We've got a school that's on fire down there. They are really getting after education, and we really appreciate everything that they do there, every parent and every child that's there, and every teacher to make that a successful elementary school. And the recipient is Jack Elementary Library, and the administration recommends that the board accept that donation.
Thank you, Dr. Crawford. I'll take a motion on, did we take a motion on item D yet? No. I need a motion on D.
I move that we accept the donation in D.
All right. And a second.
Second.
All right.
Second.
You're going to confuse
me
now. Any discussion?
The minutes of next.
Appreciate Jack Elementary, everything that they do. They're like their own little community down there, and they do get after it. And The board appreciates that, and we love self-reliance, and hope that many more campuses can continue that direction. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? All right, that carries. Items G and H, do you want to make a little comment on that, or would you like me to?
We both can, maybe. We've had a partnership with North Tyler Day Nursery occupying a portion of the old Griffin Elementary School for quite some time now. There's a long history of North Tyler Day Nursery in North Tyler, starting back in the 1930s, a group of local women, community leaders, decided that there was a need there for that, and we certainly want to continue that partnership. It's up for lease. However, there's still some negotiation that needs to occur between now and potentially the board actually bringing it back for approval. And then there's also another group that's requested to occupy a larger portion of that building, Great Foundations Incorporated, that we're wanting to bring back to the board as well. There's still a little bit more negotiation that needs to occur per the board's direction and the administration's agreement. So hopefully that we can get those things worked out and we can bring it back to you.
Thank you, Dr. Crawford. We want to help any organization we can, as long as it's a wise use of taxpayer funds and in the best interest of the community. And we don't have any reason to believe these aren't. We just have to, like Dr. Crawford said, we've got to work through the details a little bit further. All right, so I need a motion to table items G and H.
Mr. President.
Yes.
I make a motion that we table items G and H.
Thank you, Ms. Washington. Second?
I'll second.
All right, thank you very much. Any other discussion or comments? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That motion carries. All right, move on to curriculum consent. No, we had to item I.
Item I is an update from our last regularly scheduled board meeting about the opportunity and the consideration for to actually fence the play field at Caldwell Elementary School. It does bring our elementary schools to equity as far as having a somewhat large enough play field to run and have it in a secured fashion. There was a lot of audience participation in the last board meeting, and got some information that some of us were not aware of, and certainly we want to make sure that we have a safe facility for our students, and at the same time make sure that we protect our public property that the taxpayers provide us in a way that is economical and yet at the same time aesthetically pleasing enough to that part of the community. So the recommendation is in front of you for the addition of the actual fencing. A large portion of it will mirror the same type of fencing that you currently see at Robert E. Lee and at John Tyler High Schools, along with what the plan project that's already been approved at Hogg. So you'll have some of the faux wrought iron, some of the brick columns, and the black vinyl gauge fencing in other areas as well.
Thank you, Dr. Crawford. Is it okay if Mr. Loper comes and talks a little bit? I've got
Come on up, Mr. Loper.
Two questions, and board members may have a few others. How are
Thank you?
Good.
I'm good.
Can you just give us a brief overview of the types of fence and where it's going to be on that site?
Yes, sir, I can. As you know, and as we discussed at the last board meeting, the field that is across Bodark Street, which is actually the old Tyler High football field when it's a very large area, also has baseball diamonds on it, but two-thirds of, or at least two sides of the street, let's see, that back street is, help me, the long side that faces the north would yeah. be all wrought iron with brick columns on 24-foot centers, just like the layout like Dr. Crawford referred to at Robert E. Lee, John Tyler, and what is planned for Hubbard. That would be wrought iron brick columns all the way down that side. And then from the boat arc running parallel with the boat arc side will have two entrances that Y off with the existing sidewalks that will also be completely, that entire side will be the wrought iron fence with the brick columns, with brick entryways. We also in the plans have a keypad and automatic gate on those, that actual side in the plans. And then from there to the back of the women's lodge building that goes back behind on the south side of the property, all the way behind Mazzio's Pizza, all the way up to Wendy's, and then back all the way to the opposite end on the west side of the campus would be Black Vinyl. Then we'll run all the way up our property line, have two big gates in our parking lot there for not only for emergency vehicles, but so we can get maintenance equipment into the site. And then we actually have a basketball court there. It jumps up on top of the wall. We're still with the Black Vinyl fence all the way back towards the north and along the houses there, back up to the wrought iron fence where we started. So it's quite a project. It will be, we haven't chosen the brick because you haven't approved it, but we will. And the plan is to choose the brick that is very similar to what we have on the gymnasium across the street, which is your kind of your red iron rake textured brick. And I think we can get close to that with the cast stone cap columns on it, just like you've seen in the past. It will look very nice, and it will blend in. And our goal is to maintain the heritage and the time frame that the actual field was constructed.
The streets that surround that perimeter are Woldert and Boyd Art, y'all know that, and then Bonner. Bonner on the west side, but that's on the other side of those houses.
Thank you. I could not think of Woldert.
All right, board members, questions?
Mr. Loper, will the community be able to use this field once the it is fenced and gated?
I believe we can work something out. I think that's a decision between the board and the administration, and I don't look at it as any different than any other field that we have.
Well, the reason I asked, you mentioned a keypad.
Yes,
is that going to be the only entrance to the field?
Well, keypads can be keyed open and keypads can be keyed to lock. So
it will have the ability to, at a certain time of day, for the citizens to be able to use it?
Yes, ma'am. We can set it up that way.
We'll meet code on the entrances.
All right.
And then we can control the card reader access through Wi-Fi. So, you know, when it's time for the students to be on there, I think the recommendation probably will be that it's for student school use only. And then through the Wi-Fi, we can program for after-hour use as well. And then, of course, we also use that through our facility usage agreements to turn the lights on at night for soccer or football practice or Little League as well.
How tall is the fence going to be?
6 feet.
On every side?
Yes, sir.
And then on some of that, on the south, you've got some walls.
They're concrete walls, and we're coring the top of the walls and mounting right to the top.
Go in the top 6 feet
from
there.
So you'd actually be even taller in some places.
Okay. All right. I think that clears it up for me, board. Any other? Oh, I had one other. The winning bid is quite a bit lower than the rest of them.
Yes, sir.
Any idea why? You know, it seems like the material cost would be pretty standard, no matter.
Yeah, we're actually, RPR went after it. I mean, they've done all of our Robert E. Lee fence. They know what it takes.
Okay.
And they just wanted that project.
Okay. So that fact that they've done work for us similar to this, they're not going to say, whoops, I missed something.
And their subcontractors, actually the fencing contractor, is a local company and has done almost all of our fencing.
Okay. So. All right. I'll take a motion to approve item I.
I move to approve item I.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. Any more discussion?
No, I know the Caldwell community is excited about this, and I know, pursuant to the last board meeting, that they'll feel safer out there. And as Dr. Crawford said, it's equitable, kind of matches the rest of the elementary things we got going on over there as far as fencing goes. So I think it'll look great, and they'll be excited. Now we need to put some speed bumps there to make it even safer. Get with the city on that.
Yeah. I appoint Mr. Washerman, a committee member, to work with the city on that.
Help me out, Betty.
All right. Any other discussion? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Opposed? That motion carries. All right. Curriculum instruction consent agenda. I know Dr. Crawford wanted to make, did you want to make comments on B?
Absolutely.
Anybody have any others that they want to ask questions on or make comments on? All right. Then I'll entertain a motion for the other three.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve Roman numeral 11, A, B, and D.
A, C, and D. Okay. Motion's made. Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Very well. Any discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That carries. 7-0, item B.
All right. This is always a fun item to bring in front of the board for action. It's the adoption of the calendar for the 2016-17 academic year. And this year was a little different because of House Bill 2610, where statute allows for you to look at instructional minutes versus the old model of instructional days. And we had a pretty good discussion about this in our first reading. We did some prep work in our workshop as well, as far as giving the board the opportunity to understand what 2610 looked like. And administration was able to express what their thoughts were after the calendar was brought to them for consideration before we brought it to the board for your first reading from the district planning committee as well. They did a lot of great work. I want to make sure that I commend Dr. Joe Coburn for doing that, and all the members of the DPC who gave up their time and energy to really study and try to make this plan work. I can say that there are a lot of districts that are choosing to go the route that we're going and not diverting away from the 177 or so approximate instructional day model. There are some schools in West Texas that have extended the school day quite significantly, and that are exiting school at on May 18th, so the middle of May. So we just did not think that that was the best thing instructionally for our students, and certainly getting out in May does add a cost for our teachers for their own personal children and their daycare, along with our community who expects us to educate our kids. So let's just go through the calendar and talk about some of the highlights here. We did receive quite a ton of feedback, a lot of positive feedback about the proposed calendar from a variety of individuals, staff, parents, and community members. And there was also some concerns, and I think the calendar that you have in front of you actually addressed that concern that really stayed true throughout the proposal. So let's start in August. August, the week of the 15th, you'll notice that all of our professional development days when we return from summer break are actually in 1 week. Remember, the proposed the first reading calendar actually had gone short burst with the week before. We actually split 5 days up between those 2 weeks. There are districts that do that. We had heard that from our teachers, that 5 days just weren't going to work for them. They'd like to see if we could break it up a little bit. And by the time we put it out there, there were a lot of staff that contacted the district administration office and said, hey, there's going to be some personal daycare expenses that we would not like to incur. Plus the fact that a lot of them said that, hey, when we're back, we're back. And so that we understood that as well. So you've got a week of continuing education there and professional development. The convocation is on the 19th, that Friday. And then when we come back, we're actually going to try something here. And I think we've done this before in Tyler ISD. We're actually having a midweek start. And it gives our teachers and our staff the 22nd and the 23rd the opportunity to spend some time in their classroom and get ready for students. That is one common theme that we've heard when we get, when we take all of our professional development all the way up to that 1 week, that Friday, is that we don't have time to spend in our classroom. So we actually went ahead and put those two work days on the 22nd, 23rd to get ready for students. First day of school being the 24th. Labor Day is Labor Day, and we're going to make sure that we protect that. As we roll through October, we have, I guess that's Columbus Day on October the 10th. That's a professional development day. I think it's a bank holiday at the same time. The yellow is testing, so that's all throughout the calendar. And then we get to Thanksgiving. And this is kind of a compromise because we got a lot of feedback from the community and business, you know, the folks that are working, folks that don't really get that whole week off that do have students in the district that question why there's that week-long Thanksgiving break. Now, the staff overwhelmingly, I think, does want that protected. That is the recommendation tonight. Now, I think maybe later on we start looking at getting out before Memorial Day. If we decide to go that route, that there's going to have to be some negotiations, some compromise, and those days given back. That will be up for the board to direct the superintendent to do. So there's a 9-day break in there for Thanksgiving. We hope that our staff will take advantage of those days and do a lot of Christmas shopping during those days, and that those 3 weeks that we come back in December, that we do not take a 3-day weekend of a personal day to go maybe to San Marcos to go shopping. If we're getting a whole week off at Thanksgiving, we hope that we can take advantage of all the sales that go on at that time. That's just a personal statement right there.
Spend the money in Tyler.
That's right. December. This was another compromise because there's a lot of school districts that are taking the 3 days off, the 19th, 20th, and 21st, to actually go to school. Those are some days that could be allocated towards the back end. If we were to go to school at those days, that you could actually get out a little sooner. But we protected those. Our staff said that they wanted the full 2 weeks off at Christmas. Because Christmas lands on a Sunday this year, and New Year's lands on a Sunday, it's kind of when it's at the very front of the week like that, it's very hard to say we're going to take the entire week off. However, our staff, we compromised there, and protected that as well. January 2nd is a work day. That was another thing that our staff had said that they would really like an opportunity to get back into their classrooms to really prepare for our students. Also, there's a possibility that we may end the semester before Christmas. We've been prisoners of time into the old 6 weeks model when there are really not 6 weeks. And as long as you're following the scope and sequence, there's certainly the opportunity to actually end the semester at that nice cut point. And so I've heard that from especially advanced placement parents and students that those 2 weeks that you come back after you've had a 2 week break, it sure is hard to get back in the groove with the rigor. So it's something that's considered. We're not set on that yet. So we go through February, we are protecting Martin Luther King Day. That was something that was given to us that said in the proposed calendar that we're even going to school on Martin Luther King Day. That was never discussed. I don't know where that came from, but the 16th is certainly there. We're not having a professional development day on the 13th for that 4-day weekend. We found that a lot of staff, or some staff, were taking that day off, using a personal day on that professional development day. Mm-hmm. And certainly we don't, that's not what we need to do. If we're gonna have a professional development day or work day, we'd like our staff to be there. So we thought that the opportunity there to have school that weekend is a big win for our students as well. February 20th is President's Day. We've just, I think we, something we need to observe to honor those that do that. Plus, it's a bank holiday. Then you get to March. I do believe that all of our spring breaks with higher ed and Tyler ISD are aligned in this calendar. It's actually a little bit deeper into March, which is not always the case. Usually it's determined by when testing is. April, we're protecting Good Friday because we used to roll the dice and play a little poker about whether or not we'd have bad weather days or not. And then last year when we got stung with a couple of bad weather days, Reverend Mason looked at me and says, "Doc, we got to take Good Friday off. You know that." And so that's why I said, from here on out, Good Friday is Good Friday. We're going to take that Friday off. Then you get into May, the sprint to May. There's Memorial Day there with the last day of school being on June 2nd. There are no bad weather days. That is one thing that you don't make those days up when you come back. So you don't have to go to the back end of the school year and add those days when students are ready for summer break and you're just pretty much showing up to school to not be very engaged. So that's a win. Again, you know, the 6 weeks breaks, the grading periods are not on this calendar. We're going to leave that up to a committee of teachers to set that, teachers and administrators to set that to see if we actually want to do that. You know, the proponents of that say that you really look at the spring semester and look at all the yellow that's up there, and those are usually testing days. And so the number of days of actual instruction are pretty balanced in the first semester and the second semester when you start looking at all the days that are blown up because of standardized testing. And thank goodness that we didn't have the 15 standardized tests that we were supposed to do. Senator Shapiro, I think, proposed that way back in 11 or 09. They've cut it back down to 5, but we still have a lot of testing that we have to proctor, and that does balance out the semesters there. The detractors against this calendar might say that the elective courses may not quite get as many instructional days, but I think it's a good calendar. We're not going to give up on the opportunity to look at minutes in future years, but we certainly don't want to make the pendulum shift all the way to something that we're used to and that we can't do. Anyways, any questions about the calendar? I'd love to take them or comments.
I'm sure the teachers are very happy with this calendar.
Well, I think that any time that you talk about 2,700 staff persons and, you know, approximately 1,600 teachers, it's not going to be 100%. So we tried to thumb through all of the comments again, protect some of the things that the teachers really value, listen to some of the things that the community would like to see, and make the best decision that we possibly could for student achievement.
Okay. We'll go ahead and get a motion to approve the calendar under item B.
I so move.
Second.
Second it.
Thank you, Reverend Hager. Any other discussion?
If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Dr. Crawford, for working on that. You put a lot of time and effort into that, and that's done for this year. Next, we move to superintendent staff reports under board and trustees, and superintendent goal number 2 is to provide quality instruction and educator development to improve student achievement, and you've got an item there.
Yes, sir. Certainly, we, part of the board's direction, they'd like to have consistent routine updates on some of the initiatives that we do have going. And we have joining us right now our two chief administrative officers of Tyler ISD, Dr. Christy Hansen and Mr. Raleigh Sanchez, to provide the board the opportunity to ask them questions and maybe some opportunities to describe the partnership that we're hopefully entering into with the University of Texas at Tyler. So, Mr. Sanchez and Dr. Hansen.
Good evening, board. Thank you for the opportunity to present a proposal. Understanding this is yet a proposal because the deadline is scheduled to, it's supposed to be tomorrow, so this is simply a proposal. And the proposal is in collaboration with the University of Texas, Tyler at Texas, where we are providing teachers professional development with our kids that are labeled ELL or ELI. And so the intent of this grant would be housed with University of Texas at Tyler in conjunction with some of our teachers and giving them an opportunity to be better at their craft of teaching with our kids that are ELL. We understand and realize that the growing population of our Hispanic and our ELL kids is increasing every year. And so this grant will provide an opportunity for us as a district to benefit with our teaching staff in reaching kids that historically we have not been able to reach through professional development. And the professional development would encompass a lot of elbow-to-elbow professional development, where they would have some additional resources, such as personnel, that would will give our teachers some additional instruction, some additional models that they could follow, and they would be in the classroom providing feedback at the same time. This is a grant that would encompass over a five-year period of time, somewhere near $500,000 a year. And so that's it in the capsule.
All right. Any questions, board members?
Is this teachers that are bilingual certified, not bilingual certified? Are these just, like, which teachers are they?
So it would be all teachers. It would include all teachers that teach students that are ELL or ELI. It would be an opportunity for all of our teachers to take advantage, an opportunity to be better at their craft of teaching. It would also give us the opportunity for administrators, assistant principals, and principals to take advantage of the professional development as well.
Mr. Sanchez, you said all teachers. If I understand this proposal, there's two phases. The first is a developmental phase focused on just four campuses, and then the latter portion is, assuming success, expands to all teachers, all ELL teachers in the district. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
The first phase includes four schools to be identified at this point, because we have to be able to look at the data of the schools that have the highest population of ESL kids and the opportunity to make sure that we can get it right the first time so that we're not having to clean up later. And so a lot of times when we roll out grants, we roll out proposals, we have a tendency sometimes to bite off more than we can chew, and then we're having to clean up later. This gives us an opportunity to get it right at the beginning so that we have success, even more success, at the end.
The language develop seems, it can imply that it doesn't exist currently. Is this an existing model with good research behind it that you're going to customize the implementation of here in Tyler ISD? Or is it something that is being developed during implementation in conjunction with UT?
So that would be a twofold. The first would be there is research that indicates that there are other districts and there are other schools that are having great success with ELL students. And so this is also an opportunity to craft our own professional development for the success of ELL students. So it's a both. It's a win-win for us because we're able to take the research-based success that other people have been able to do, and then we're also able to create our own successes along the way.
Is this a competitive grant? And another question, tomorrow is the deadline for application. When is the implementation date? When is it supposed to be implemented?
So the implementation is competitive. There is somewhere near $23 million available through the entire grant. And as you can imagine, everybody is applying for it. So it is very competitive. The response to the second question would be, yes, it would go into implementation next school year, but there's already been a lot of legwork. Thank you to Ms. Nanango, our bilingual education specialist for the district, who's done a lot of legwork. Dr. Hansen also did a lot of legwork last year when this initial grant came out, and then there was a stall, and so we picked back up at the beginning this year looking at it.
I do have one more question. Sorry.
The
additional staff that's to be hired, this is with grant funding, correct, and contingent on the continuation of the grant.
That is correct. And I might add that as we went through the discussion of this grant, we did request, and we're pretty insistent that through the hiring process, that we had an opportunity to sit at the table through the interview process, because we wanted them to understand that it's our district, it's our students, it's our teachers. Mm-hmm. We want to own the responsibility of hiring the absolute best people we can find and just not allow somebody else to pick them for us.
Thank you.
Okay. Look forward to getting an update on that after the grant's awarded, and hopefully we've got some good news coming there. Thank you, guys.
Raleigh, don't forget to put the flag back wherever you hit it.
Dr. Crawford, I can handle future business.
It's all yours.
Board workshop on March 17th, the day after spring break. And a regular board meeting, I think it's the day after, isn't it? Yeah, regular board meeting on the 24th.
That Monday after spring break may have to be reconsidered. We'll talk about that tomorrow, probably, Gina. So we'll figure something out. We'll have something for you. We've got some work we need to do.
The 17th is actually Thursday.
The 17th is a Thursday?
Okay.
So it's a Thursday after spring break.
It's the Thursday after spring break.
There you go.
And leaving the regular meeting back a week.
That's correct.
Very good, then. Okay, if we don't have any future business, then I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you for coming.